Hey, what's going on, Shalom? I'm gonna do a video with you guys, compilation. You know what I mean? Malcolm X, Martin Luther King, Stephen Darby, about certain things, and just a little compilation video. So let me know how you enjoy it. All right.
At the very same time that America refused to give the Negro any land, through an act of Congress, our government was giving away millions of acres of land in the West and the Midwest, which meant that it was willing to undergird its white peasants from Europe with an economic floor. But not only did they give the land, they built land-grant colleges with government money to teach them how to farm. Not only that, they provided county agents to further their expertise in farming. Not only that, they provided low interest rates in order that they could mechanize their farms. Not only that, today, many of these people are receiving millions of dollars in federal subsidies not to farm, and they are the very people telling the black man that he ought to lift himself by his own bootstraps. Now, this is what we are faced with, and this is the reality. Now, when we come to Washington in this campaign, we are coming to get our check.
What's it? It disappeared.
Wait a minute. It didn't disappear. You might forget Martin Luther King was assassinated in April. The Poor People's Campaign was supposed to go to Washington in April. Mm-hmm. So the organization that mobilized it was essentially decapitated and thrown into chaos about 3 weeks before it was supposed to happen. Mm-hmm. Those organizations were being, as I said, once the Civil Rights Acts were completed, that was it. Mm-hmm. Government was through with us. They're not interested in restructuring. There has never been any interest in restructuring the economy for the benefit of the poor. I don't know where you're going to talk about the bonus army, go back to Shays' Rebellion. I mean, this is like the no-no. You know, this is a capitalist society. It's built on inequality and avarice in many ways. Mm-hmm.
I lifted my screen up. Watch it flickering. It just comes and goes. Look at that. It's 2 a.m. I don't see anyone else outside right now seeing this. I know for a fact it's not a forest fire or anything. I live in a city. But the whole southern sky is just brightly lit orange. This is nuts. Oh my god. I'm gonna call the police. I'm using my phone here to film this, but I wanna know what's going on. This is just, I've never seen anything like this before.
Holy fuck, look at that in the sky! Look at that in the sky! That's so fucked! Something going on in the sky right now! And it disappeared too? Five times? Holy fuck! No way! No fucking way! That's crazy as fuck! What the hell is that? What the bloody hell is that? That's crazy, bro! Crazy! Never seen anything like this! What is that? We don't know what it is!
I saw it on the highway. I'm going to take a picture. Holy.
Oh, yeah, this is unbelievable, man.
Yeah, go back, talk to battery.
Jamie.
Oh my god, oh my god!
I hit pause and all that.
Oh my
hey,
god!
Hey, Tony, check it out. Tony, check it out. Oh my god.
Whoa.
It's getting brighter.
Dude, I got a 2x lens on
this thing. You wait till later.
I can't wait till Jamie goes down there.
Dude, I'm going right now, man.
Hey, look at it.
Is a car from 5 miles
away? Look at it one time.
Is it a car from 5 miles away now?
Ooh.
It almost looks like a flame.
Yeah, how it flickers.
Yeah, it looks like a flame.
Look, it's red on it.
It's coming real close.
Yeah, you see it? It's going red now.
Man,
yeah,
in this camera, it's coming.
Okay, I just see a red light now.
Come on.
Now it's going.
I'm not going to
lights. No, I see a red light.
Drive up later and you see.
Ooh, that's not a light. There's no way. It would be moving or something. This is fucking chilling. It's only in that one spot.
What the fuck is it? Ain't no tower, because there ain't no tower over there.
The tower's way the fuck over there. It's only that one section of
the. Do you hear that? You see that? Look at this light. It's crazy. I don't know if you can hear that. It's 4 o'clock in the morning, and this has been happening almost every single night with this light in the sky. I am not gonna stay out here for this.
¿Estás viendo eso? Allá, ve el cielo. Claro, es la cosa solar. ¿Eh? Sí, vámonos. Vámonos rápido. Ponte.
This is in Anaheim, California, by the way, guys. So this is going viral. Mira, pero es que ahí se ve en el fondo, mira. Ahí está, ahí se ve la. You can see a ship. Wow. Look, se quedó parado. Mira el teléfono, miren el teléfono. Damn, that looks badass. Ahí se ve que está palpitando y acá vamos. Oh wow, it went away.
You can keep going in denial, but now we are seeing this worldwide. This is a fiery planet. It is mentioned in science as Coral 7b. It is mentioned in ancient times as Nibiru, the 10th planet. I personally call it planet hell because it has a hot side and a cool side, and it is the hell literally being brought to this earth. This comes when the Gentiles are at the height of their evil and wickedness. It has destroyed in the times of Pharaoh, and in the times of Noah, and in the times of Sodom and Gomorrah, and it's about to make the Gentiles land desolate now. You can believe with your eyes and your ears here right now, or you can go back to sleep. It's your choice. This is Rap the News. You've been warned.
I can tell things, when I mean things, the conditions are getting critical. And I find that some scientists also think that. And so I think when I do publish, that group anyway will agree with me full-heartedly.
On your conclusions. When you say things are getting critical, are you talking about something to do with the vehicles that are in the rings of Saturn?
Yes, yeah.
Really?
Yeah. You see, it's sort of simple. That's a lot of energy.
Right.
And.
Okay. And this is the ring, right? This part, this is the ring?
That ends up being the ring.
Yeah.
It's hot plasma.
Oh, really? Okay. So, and they're, what your theory is, they're manufacturing it. Is that correct?
It comes, that's the exhaust from this thing.
From the craft?
Yes.
Is it because, are they stationary or are they moving, the craft?
They're probably moving.
So do you think, when you say things are getting critical, are you
saying... Okay, just take that picture and say that's the exhaust. It's like you have an airplane with an exhaust. Mm-hmm. It's in your atmosphere. And it can load a lot of energy, you know? And, but this is, Saturn, like John Lear says, you know, Saturn is the focal point, and I can't agree with him more.
Okay, but John Lear talks about Saturn actually being portal into another dimension.
Well, you know, he's theorizing.
Yeah, so you don't necessarily go there.
I don't go that way.
Uh-huh.
I either say, this is the way it is, or I can't tap it.
Okay, but you're saying things are getting critical, because I'm really curious, are you saying that those craft are coming here? Is that why it's critical?
No, I'm saying, in effect, if they do, and there's a good probability that that is possible, then, hey, you got to get with it. You can't wait around.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, but you see, no one really in this country accepts the concept that at Saturn, those things are there.
Right.
As you can't do it at Saturn, where else, you know, you just can't have it. People have got to be made to understand that those things are real.
Right.
Now, there are two images. We were taken by the Hubble telescope of Saturn this last year, 2012.
Okay.
That shows objects under the rings and one just right to the edge. Like I said, they were.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Is that Cassini? Is that our? Did the photographs come from Cassini?
The last ones, no. The ones I told you about that shows those.
Right.
Those are Hubble's.
Those are from Hubble.
Yeah.
But am I wrong? They closed down Hubble, right?
Yeah.
Or that's the official story. Right.
Wherever they closed it down is 2012 before they show you the picture.
It's 2012 before they show you the picture. What do you mean by
that? And I was able to tell that before 1985.
Yes. So you were way ahead of everyone.
Way ahead.
Yeah.
And that is too long to tolerate that kind of science. Mm-hmm. It's just too long. Now, I have three reports, on the environment, let's say, in UNESCO, but they're yay thick. All three of them weigh 18 pounds, or about 6 pounds each. And they have to vote on what they think goes on. That is not science.
They have to vote?
That's not science.
That's absolutely
right. But they sell it to you as though it's science. It is not science. Mm-hmm. Okay? Mm-hmm. And that is the hump that you can help get us over.
Okay.
Hey, those things are real.
Okay, but there are, if there are craft, there are beings.
Okay, people would have asked me about, I call them vehicles, okay?
Right.
Now, I did not call them objects. That was too neuter for me.
Okay.
I had a Stanford professor say, you ought to call them objects, normally. No. They have all of the qualities of a vehicle. Mm-hmm. They can move. You know, they're just like a missile or anything like that. So that much we can say about them, for sure.
Okay.
So I'm calling them in.
Okay.
Okay, somebody comes along and says, well, now where would you manufacture one that's 2.5 Earth lengths long? And that's a hard question to answer. However, if you think of it in terms of its living entity, it's just another kind of thing that we've got in our universe. And it can grow and grow and grow and grow.
Okay, so
it can be an EMV and it can itself have life.
Uh-huh. So are you not positing the idea that those vehicles contain, you know, beings who are, you know, maybe like us?
Yeah, I only go along with government images. And if you want to know about people kind of thing, there is the ship that picked up the Voyager capsule at the Alameda Naval Shipyard, and they have a picture there of I think it's the Apollo flight that Buzz and Neil were on. But anyway, there is one image there that shows black people getting off.
So people with dark skin getting off?
Not dark, black.
Black skin?
Really black, yeah.
Were they tall?
Yes.
Very tall?
Yeah.
How tall? Do you know?
Well, they got out the doorway. I don't know how high that is, but
well, what
it's safe. Seven feet would be probably a conservative estimate.
Have you heard about Clark McClellan's statement about that?
No.
Oh, you haven't?
No.
Have you ever been in touch with him?
No.
No?
I have tried to stay independent and not be affected by others' opinions.
Mm-hmm.
I would rather have what I present clash with somebody else and see who wins.
Okay.
And settle it that way, mm-hmm. rather than make a shouting match over it.
Sure.
I learned at Ames that the longer you shouted, the more probable it was that you would get your way. And I don't want to go through that routine.
Okay, well, good for you.
Speak. Civil Rights, King, Van Oker, Roll 20, Sound 36.
Dr. King, this church is as good a place as any to go back over your commitment to the civil rights movement. When you went out from here into university and then you went to Montgomery, Alabama and started the bus boycotts there, what was the philosophy of the civil rights movement as you saw it then, more than 10 years ago?
Well, I would say then the philosophy was that we must go all out to use legal and nonviolent methods to gain full citizenship rights for the Negro people of our country. Now, of course, that particular struggle and that philosophy centered on breaking down all of the barriers of legal segregation. So I would say that in that period, the basic thrust for the gaining of citizenship rights for Negroes was to end the humiliation surrounding the whole system of legal segregation.
Dr. King, was there something peculiar to the place where you started and the kind of people you attracted? I mean by that, there was a strong attachment on the part of your parishioners in Montgomery to the church. They were older people, weren't they?
Yes, I would say by and large they were older people who participated in the boycott because they were the ones using the bus more than anybody else. And Montgomery was a community predominantly church-centered, so that it was very easy to get to the vast majority of Negroes because they were in some way connected with a church in the community.
Was there, in addition to your commitment to the idea of nonviolence, wasn't it also the only thing you could do, the white community having the monopoly on violence, that if you had tried violence, they would have met it with violence? It was the only device open to you, wasn't it?
Well, I'll put it another way, that morally, I was led to nonviolence because I felt that it was the best moral way to deal with the problem. We were seeking to establish a just society. And it was my feeling then, and it is my feeling now, that violence is certainly much more socially destructive, and it creates many more social problems than it solves. So I was led to nonviolence for deep moral reasons. Now, there is no doubt about the fact that in our struggle in Montgomery and all over the United States for that matter, nonviolence is also practically sound. It would just be impractical for the Negro to turn to violence. He has neither the instruments nor the techniques of violence. We are about 10 or 11% of the total population of the nation, and I would say we are about 0.1% of the firepower. So it would just be totally impractical and unwise and unrealistic for the Negro to think of violence. Well, I saw this in the beginning in Montgomery, but this wasn't the basic reason that I turned to nonviolence and that I believed in it as a philosophy. I turned to it because I felt that it was the morally excellent way to deal with the problem of racial injustice in our country.
Is there something about nonviolence that made it, and I use that in the past tense, that made it more useful among Southern Negroes than the ghetto Negroes of the North?
I wouldn't say there's anything that makes it more useful to Southern Negroes. I think it is true that we've had more nonviolent movements in the South because the problem for many years was more crystallized and, in a sense, more visible in the South. We didn't have many civil rights activities on a massive scale in the North until 3 or 4 years ago. So I would say that we just haven't had a chance to experiment on a broad scale with nonviolence in the Northern Ghetto. I have the feeling that nonviolence is as applicable and workable in the Northern Ghetto as it is in the South. Now, there's a larger job there. The frustrations at points are much deeper. The bitterness is deeper. And I think that's because in the South, we can see pockets of progress here and there. We've really made some strides that are very visible, and every Southern Negro knows that he can do things today that he couldn't do 4 or 5 years ago. Where in the North, the Negro sees only retrogress, and he doesn't find it as easy to get his vision centered on his target, the target of opposition, as he does in the South. Consequently, this is made for despair and at many points cynicism, a feeling that you can't win. And it simply means that we've got to develop in the North a massive job of organization and mobilizing forces and resources to deal with the problem in the urban ghettos of the North, just as we've done it in the South.
Well, in the South, particularly in Alabama, you had visible villains, Jim Clark, Bull Connor, cattle prods, police dogs. But in the North, you don't have those visible villains. Isn't it hard to get your people aroused and directed at something that isn't visible?
Well, that's exactly right. And this is what I was saying when I said it's harder to see a target. In the South, in the nonviolent movement, we were aided always on the whole by the brutality of our opponent. It isn't the same way in the North. The other thing is that you don't have legal segregation in the North as you do in the South. So it is much more difficult to get people to see exactly what you're doing, but it isn't an impossible job. It's a hard, it's a tedious job at times to get people to be aroused from their apathetic slumbers, but I still feel that Negroes in the North can be motivated just as they were motivated in the South. And I think as time goes on with the growing economic deprivation in the Negro community, it will even be easier because people will come to see that not only is something wrong in general, but something is wrong in particular in their own economic and housing situations.
Well, what is it? I mean, how do you find it? It's very subtle in the North, is it not?
It's subtle, but it's becoming much more visible. Anybody can see that the schools are more segregated in the North today than they were in 1954 when the Supreme Court rendered its decision declaring segregation unconstitutional. Anybody can look around the ghetto and see that ghetto schools are predominantly segregated and devoid of quality. Anyone who moves through a major ghetto of our country will see the housing conditions. People don't have to be reminded that they are forced to live in slums in many instances, and they're often rat-infested, vermin-filled slums. And it isn't too hard to see the exploitation that the Negro confronts in the ghetto, where he is forced to pay more for less and constantly trying to make ends meet, but because of either no job as a result of unemployment or a job that is so economically unprofitable that the person can't make ends meet. And I think they see all of these things, and more they are coming to see them, because before, the people of the North were looking to the South and they supported the struggles of the South. Now they are coming to see that their problems are very real and they've got to organize to grapple with them.
Was there something hypocritical about the fact that the South existed and the North could point the finger? And then when the Civil Rights Acts were passed in the early 60s, you couldn't point the finger anymore?
Well, there was no doubt about the hypocrisy of large segments of the nation on the whole question of racial equality. I think the best example is that many of the senators from the North and the West, and congressmen generally, who voted for civil rights legislation in 64 and even 65 with the Voting Rights Bill, refused last year to vote for civil rights legislation because it dealt with an issue applicable to the North, the whole housing question. And this, it seems to me, was the greatest expression of the hypocrisy of many of our citizens and many of the senators and congressmen of the North.
But isn't that part of the dilemma now? That people knew that Negroes were being denied what was guaranteed to them by the Constitution, by the fact that they were citizens of this country. Then when they were given those rights, do you feel the white community said, well, we've given them all that we have, now it's up to them?
Well, I think the dilemma is much deeper, and I think one during this period of transition has to be very honest with America. And honesty impels me to admit that America has broad racist elements still alive. Racism is still existing in American society in many areas of the society, North and South. And the other thing is that there has never been a single, solid, determined commitment of large segments of white America on the whole question of racial equality. I think we have to see that vacillation has always existed, ambivalence has always existed, and this to me is the so-called white backlash. It's merely a new name for an old phenomenon. I see the white backlash as a continuation of the same ambivalence and vacillation of white America on the whole question of racial justice that has existed since the founding of our nation. I think the other thing that we must see at this time is that many of the people who supported us in Selma, in Birmingham, were really outraged about the extremist behavior toward Negroes. But they were not at that moment, and they are not now, committed to genuine equality for Negroes. It's much easier to integrate a lunch counter than it is to guarantee an annual income, for instance, to get rid of poverty for Negroes and all poor people. It's much easier to integrate a bus than it is to make genuine integration a reality and quality education a reality in our schools. It's much easier to integrate even a public park than it is to get rid of slums. And I think we are in a new era, a new phase of the struggle, where we have moved from a struggle for decency, which characterized our struggle for 10 or 12 years, to a struggle for genuine equality. And this is where we are getting the resistance, because there was never any intention to go this far. People were reacting to Bull Connor and to Jim Clark rather than acting in good faith for the realization of genuine equality.
Do you think white people in this country, and I'm talking about non-segregationists, people devoid or thinking they're devoid of racism, do you have any idea of what they want the Negro to be in America?
Well, it depends on the level that we are talking here, because I think you have to make a distinction between the people who are genuinely and absolutely committed in the white community on the question of racial equality. And I must confess that I think they're in a very small minority. I think the vast majority of white Americans will go but so far. It's a kind of installment plan for equality. And they are always looking for an excuse to go but so far.
Why are they looking for the excuse? What is it about the Negro? I mean, every other group that came as an immigrant somehow, not easily, but somehow got around it. Is it just the fact that Negroes are black?
That's a part of it, and growing, that grows out of something else. You can't thingify anything without depersonalizing that something. If you use something as a means to an end, at that moment you make it a thing and you depersonalize it. The fact is that the Negro was a slave in this country for 244 years. That act, that was a willful thing that was done. The Negro was brought here in chains, treated in very inhuman fashion. And this led to the thingification of the Negro. So he was not looked upon as a person. He was not looked upon as a human being with the same status and worth as other human beings. And the other thing is that human beings cannot continue to do wrong without eventually rationalizing that wrong. So slavery was justified morally, biologically, theoretically, scientifically, everything else. And it seems to me that white America must see that no other ethnic group has been a slave on American soil. That is one thing that other immigrant groups haven't had to face. The other thing is that the color became a stigma. American society made the Negro's color a stigma. And that can never be overlooked. So I think these things are absolutely necessary. The other thing is that America freed the slaves in 1863 through the Emancipation Proclamation of Abraham Lincoln, but gave the slaves no land or nothing in reality, and as a matter of fact, to get started on. At the same time, America was giving away millions of acres of land in the West and the Midwest, which meant that there was a willingness to give the white peasants from Europe an economic base. And yet it refused to give its black peasants from Africa, who came here involuntarily in chains and had worked free for 244 years, any kind of economic base. And so emancipation for the Negro was really freedom to hunger. It was freedom to the winds and rains of heaven. It was freedom without food to eat or land to cultivate, and therefore it was freedom and famine at the same time. And when white Americans tell the Negro to lift himself by his own bootstraps, they don't look over the legacy of slavery and segregation. I believe we ought to do all we can and seek to lift ourselves by our own bootstraps, but it's a cruel jest to say to a bootless man that he ought to lift himself by his own bootstraps. And many Negroes, by the thousands and millions, have been left bootless as a result of all of these years of oppression and as a result of a society that deliberately made his color a stigma and something worthless and degrading.
Apart from wanting to live better, which all of us want to do, to raise one's children in a better way, to be better, does the Negro in America know what he wants to be?
I'm convinced that almost every Negro in this country, other than those who have been so scarred by the system that they've become pathological in the process, and we all have to battle with pathology, nobody really knows what it means to be a Negro unless one can really experience it. And I know we all have to battle with this constant drain of a feeling of nobodiness. But in spite of this, I think the vast majority of Negroes in this country know that they want to be people, they want to be men. They want equality, period. It just boils down to that. And we haven't been able to be people. We haven't been men because of all of the conditions that we've lived with and the syndrome of deprivation surrounding conditions, whether it's in housing, in the economic area, or in schools, or in the vicious credit practices that we face in the ghetto, and all of the problems of closed doors and constant defeats. But in spite of all this, I think we all know basically that we want to be men. We want to be persons judged not on the basis of the color of our skin, but on the basis of the content of our character.
But you know that many young Negroes don't want anything that smacks of the American white middle class. But do they want something that smacks of whatever is the black middle class, or do they just not want bourgeois values, which after all are the basis of this democracy?
Well, I think we have to see what they are saying. I would be the first to agree that integration does not mean giving up everything that has an Afro-American taint, so to speak, a background. I think there are certain unique things within any culture and certain cultural patterns that when you get to the process of amalgamation can really lift the whole culture. And it seems to me that integration at its best is the opportunity to participate in the beauty of diversity. I think the other thing that we've got to see is that these young people are saying that there must be a revolution of values in our country. As Jimmy Baldwin said on one occasion, what advantage is there in being integrated into a burning house? And I feel that there is a need for a revolution of values in America, because some of the values that presently exist are certainly out of line with the values and the idealistic structure that brought our nation into being. Unfortunately, we haven't been true to these ideals, and many of the values of so-called white middle-class society are values that need to be reviewed and re-evaluated, and in a real sense, they need to be changed. So I think the young people in the Negro community who are raising these questions are raising some very profound questions about our total society. In other words, they are saying that there must be a restructuring of the architecture of our society where values are concerned. And with this, I would agree with. So in the quest for integration, I think we can offer our whole nation something, because there are three evils in our nation. It's not only racism, but economic exploitation of poverty would be one, and then militarism. And I think in a sense, and in a very real sense, these three are tied inextricably together, and we aren't going to get rid of one without getting rid of the other.
When you stood on the Lincoln Memorial that day in August, 63, and you said, I had a dream, did that dream envision that you could see a war in Asia preventing the federal government doing for the Negroes, preventing the society doing for the Negroes, that which you think had to be done?
No, I didn't envision that then. I must confess that that period was a great period of hope for me, and I'm sure for many others all across the nation, many of the Negroes who had about lost hope, saw a solid decade of progress in the South. And in 1954, which was, 64, 1963, 9 years after the Supreme Court's decision to be in the March on Washington, meant a great deal. It was a high moment, a great watershed moment. But I must confess that that dream that I had that day has at many points turned into a nightmare. Now, I'm not one to lose hope. I keep on hoping. I still have faith in the future. But I've had to analyze many things over the last few years, and I would say over the last few months. I've gone through a lot of soul-searching and agonizing moments, and I've come to see that we have many more difficult days ahead, and some of the old optimism was a little superficial, and now it must be tempered with a solid realism. And I think the realistic fact is that we still have a long, long way to go, and that we are involved in a war on Asian soil, which, if not checked and stopped, can poison the very soul of our nation.
Dr. King, even if there had not been a war in Asia, would you still not have had this nightmare, insofar as the Negro movement for equality then touched on two things that the white community holds sacred, their children and their property?
Oh, I have no doubt that we would have encountered great difficulties, great problems of resistance, if the war had not been in existence. So that I'm not going to say that all of our problems would be solved if the war in Vietnam is ended. But I do say that the war makes it infinitely more difficult to deal with these problems. When a nation becomes obsessed with the guns of war, it loses its social perspective, and programs of social uplift suffer. This is just a fact of history, so that we do face many more difficulties as a result of the war. It's much more difficult to really arouse the conscience during a time of war. I noticed the other day, some weeks ago, a Negro was shot down in Chicago, and it was a clear case of police brutality. That was on page 30 of the paper, but on page 1 at the top was 780 Viet Cong killed. That is something about a war like this that makes people insensitive. It dulls the conscience. It strengthens the forces of reaction, and it brings into being bitterness and hatred and violence, and it strengthened the military-industrial complex of our country, and it's made our job much more difficult, because I think we can go along with some programs, if we didn't have this war on our hands, that would cause people to adjust to new developments, just as they did in the South. They said they'd never ride the bus with us, blood would flow in the streets, they wouldn't go to school, and all of these things. But when people came to see that they had to do it because the law insisted, they finally adjusted. And I think white people all over this country will adjust once the nation makes it clear that in schools, in housing, we've got to learn to live together as brothers. I think the biggest problem now is that we got our gains over the last 12 years at bargain rate, so to speak. Didn't cost the nation anything. In fact, it helped the economic side of the nation to integrate lunch counters and public accommodations. It didn't cost the nation anything to get the right to vote established. And now we are confronting issues that cannot be solved without costing the nation billions of dollars. Now, I think this is where we're getting our greatest resistance. They may put it on many other things, but we can't get rid of slums and poverty without it costing the nation something.
Hey, NBC News viewers, thanks for checking out our YouTube channel. Subscribe by clicking on that button down here and click on any of the videos over here to watch the latest interviews, show highlights, and digital exclusives. Thanks for watching.
I hope you enjoyed this compilation video. And stay encouraged and know that our God, the Most High, will prevail. And we will become a nation again. Hands down. Shalom. And for Edom. And for Edom, you will get destroyed. Just look at this banking system. Look at the flooding. Look at this hurricane right now in New Orleans, Hurricane Barry. This wicked system is crumbling. London Bridge has fallen. Shalom.